Recently, Proxmox has released the latest beta for Proxmox VE, the virtualization software with Proxmox 9 beta. This most recent release has a list of new features they've rolled out in the roadmap that seem kind of interesting, and it's really exciting to see that they continue to add features and update it. And in this video, I'm going to go over the new features list, with share some of my thoughts on it, try it on a system and see how the install goes, and just upgrade one of my current systems and look forward to hearing back from everyone in the comments below about what their thoughts are and if there's anything I should take a look at. Taking a look at the release notes for Proxmox 9 Beta 1, the first top level release notes is that it's based off a lot of newer software. So along with the Proxmox software being updated, a lot of the software Proxmox uses, like ZFS, Ceph, the Linux kernel, Debian, has been updated. The biggest thing to note is Debian stable has been updated from the previous stable now of Bookworm, or almost the previous stable, to Trixie, which is currently in a hard freeze, which means Debian is almost ready to release it, but it's not quite ready as a stable release. Interestingly enough, I was looking at the Debian releases and the Proxmox releases, and every new Proxmox VE version, at least recently, has had a new Debian stable version, which seems to make me think that about a little bit less than every 2 years, we'll probably be getting a new Proxmox version, as that's about how often a Debian stable version comes out as well. Looking at the Debian stable release notes, they have a lot of software under the hood that's going to be updated, and because Proxmox uses those Debian repositories, that software you use in Proxmox will also be updated. In my initial use of Debian 13 and Proxmox 9 based off this, I didn't see any major breaking issues, but overall, nice little updates, and it's nice to see you're getting newer versions of a lot of the software you use under the hood. The main thing that they aren't pulling from Debian is the Debian's provided kernel, and they're using a newer kernel, 6.14.8 kernel, which will likely be updated a little bit as 9 comes into full version. My other guess is Proxmox VE9, the full version, is going to get released once Debian stable becomes a full stable release. There's also new versions of other software under the hood, like ZFS, which supports ZFS RAID Z expansion, so I can add another drive to increase the size of my RAID Z array, which is a nice feature to see rolled into this latest stable release. Some of the actual Proxmox features they've added include better VM snapshot support. So it looks like there's a new option when you're setting up directory storage. I'll take a look at that on this box here and see how that goes. And the other big feature they're adding is better software-defined networking. This has been something they've been working on for a couple releases now, where in old versions of Proxmox, like 5 and 6, for example, they pretty much only used the KVM commu and Linux kernel provided networking bridge tools and other things. And in these recent releases, they've been adding more and more advanced networking, so I can run like a full cluster. I can run VLANs on top of VLANs, essentially, to have a shared set of VLANs between all my systems, and have a lot more flexibility in networking, and especially without requiring the switches to do everything in that, I can do it a lot within the Proxmox networking settings. Unfortunately, a lot of this sort of clustering stuff, I can't set up an easy test with a single node, but I'll try to make that into a feature later on. The other thing they talk about is it's just an easy upgrade from it, with a wiki page dedicated to the upgrade and how you can perform it. And I'm going to be upgrading one of my personal systems, so hope it works correctly and go over that process soon. It looks like a lot of the other changelog things here includes, a lot of these are just going to be bug fixes for kind of more edge cases they fixed. One thing I took a look at is they say there's improvements to backup and restore, and it says they're going to increase concurrency when restoring disks, so it can read multiple disks at the same time, which seems nice to speed things up a little bit. But one of my kind of bigger annoyances with Proxmox backups is you can't backup multiple sources at the same time to a Proxmox VE, to a PBS system. So that's a little bit annoying that it looks like they haven't implemented that here. So hopefully they'll do it one day, but it doesn't look like it's coming in 9. They also look like with storage, they have a new way of doing QEMU snapshots, where it looks like at first glance they'll make the snapshots a separate file instead of adding more to the QCAL2 file with the claims of better performance and quicker snapshot removal. We'll take a look at that a little bit on my test system. And then better management. The one cool feature under better management I'm excited about is it looks like they have a network interface pinning tool to pin the name of a network interface. This has come to bite me multiple times, as I often add devices like these NVMe or other PCIe devices to a server, go to boot it up, And now the network device has changed in the OS. So for example, from like EMP3S0 to EMP5S0. And since my config files for EMP3S0, that new and that device now that is named EMP5S0 doesn't work and just can't connect to the network. So that's going to be annoying. I'm looking forward to trying that. Looks like they've also improved some things in the installation ISO, which I have set up here. We'll take a look at in a second. So at a very quick look, notice looking at this, it's a lot of bug fixes, new software under the hood, and a couple of cool features, which for a software that I generally like and work is really cool, but no fundamental shift in how the software is going to be used. The other thing that I think is coming, there is a empty wiki page for upgrading from PBS 3 to 4, and because it looks like PBS is also getting new versions every Debian stable version, that's probably coming soon with the new Debian version, ZFS, and likely a few other features. I might make a new video if there's interest about that and how it comes out soon. So now let's take a look at installing and working with this new version of Proxmox. For an initial setup, I have a little N100 mini PC I'm just going to be using as a test bench for Proxmox 9. And I want to just go through the installer right now and just see if anything's been changed. I'm going to be going from memory here when it comes to the release, but I'm taking a look at the advanced options. I don't remember this always being here in Proxmox, but this is memtest 86. I love to see this as it's really nice to make it an easy way. It looks like they've also talked about improvements to the automated install. I'm going to probably make another video about that and see how that goes, but it's nice to see that when you're installing that. One of the things on the Proxmox roadmap they've been talking about is just making it so that you can treat it more like livestock instead of pets. And the general mentality is it's more automated and I have to play with each node less, and it's designed to work better in large clusters. And a lot of the other improvements like the SDN networking is continuing to move on this idea of Proxmox is designed for working with larger amounts of systems instead of trying to have a single box. And I think that makes sense as there's a lot of larger deployments, and they also make more money off licenses the more nodes you have. So for my install, I'm gonna be starting off just using the terminal UI because that's what I'm most familiar with. And taking a look at the system, on first glance, it looks very similar to other the Proxmox releases I've used in the past. One other interesting note I noticed was on my system, it is the largest Proxmox release at about 1.6 gigabytes on the ISO file compared to all the other Proxmox releases I've used, but it still installs very quickly. So on a system with an SSD and a fast boot device, within about 2 minutes is the actual install process. And my install is just finished, and at first glance, it looks like almost any other Proxmox system I've used. So let's dive into the web interface and see if anything major has changed and just take a poke look around it right now. So I logged into the web interface for the new version of Proxmox 9, and this is pretty darn similar to anything else you've changed. So it's not gonna be a fundamental shift in how you use it or anything really you have to relearn. They've changed a few little things under the hood with the new Debian version. So it's now like PVE dash test instead of PVE test all as one word. Taking a look at my actual system right now, Debian in the new release has changed, for example, like how apt presents what the updates are and the size of the upgrade, because I am updating my beta system right now and there's still a couple of updates. It looks like mostly in the PVE and Proxmox container word, and we can play around with that. Now, the one other way to get Proxmox 9 beta on your system is to upgrade an existing 8 system to the new OS. So let's take a look at my main home server and just give it an upgrade right now and see how it goes. So the first step in upgrading from 8 to 9 is going to be doing a full upgrade of 8 to the latest version of 8. So I'm going to do that right now. And along with updating 8 to the latest version, you're going to get a package called PVE 8 to 9, which is able to go check your system for anything that might be a potential incompatibility. And now that I've updated my system to the latest version of the PVE 8 branch, I'm going to upgrade it to version 9, starting off by doing the PVE 8 to 9 package, which is automatically installed if you update it to the latest version of 9. So let's take a look at the results on this system. This is one of my personal systems that's had a lot of little tests ran on it, so it's not in perfect condition. So running the script here, it checks versions, and it's gonna say things like I have enabled PBS servers that aren't actually running right now because I was just testing those. It's gonna say some systems have volumes in their configurations that exist but aren't working. And these are listed as warnings, which means it's not good and optimal and you're probably doing something wrong, but it probably also won't break the upgrade. So if I want to take a look at this resolved node IP, I'm guessing this is because I changed the IP of the system And in Proxmox, you don't want to just change the IP of the system, you also have to change the host's file. Now, I do want to note, all of these issues are individual system specific, and while it might technically work if you upgrade it with one of these red failures, I would highly recommend trying to get these warning and failures to zero. Moving on to the system, I'd also highly recommend looking up any known upgrade issues and taking a look at your system to see if those apply to you. Generally, it's not an issue with most systems, but some specific configs have problems, so take a look at those now. So let's take a look at the next step here. So now that I've updated my system, I need to update the repositories to have the newer version there. So what I'm going to do is I'm first going to run this command here. This little sed command will essentially edit everything in my host file. So instead of saying the old version of Bookworm, it's going to say Trixie, which is a new version. And that little sed command will just automatically edit all of those files. The next thing I want to do is I want to also make sure I do it for any other repository files I have, like if I have a PVE enterprise file or anything I may have made on the system. If you've used Debian before, you're probably used to this format of things here. But this is actually not going to be used in here anymore, and Debian has a new format. It does technically still work, but they've chosen to use a new format for putting repositories in, and you can go swap all your existing ones if you want. One thing you might notice is this format looks a bit different, and Debian has a new version of this format of how to do apt repositories they're moving to. The old version will still work, but they also have a command listed if you want to switch everything to the new version to look like this and the new Debian suggested one. Now that I've updated all the repositories, I can go back into command line, do apt update, give it a few seconds. And then once that finishes, I'm going to do an apt dist upgrade. So this is going to upgrade my distro and all of these packages, and say on my system, it's about a 585 megabyte download, and I need about 1.15 gigabytes of new disk space to do this. Depending on how fast your system is, they say under 5 minutes, which for a modern system and SSDs is about right, but can get to 20-ish minutes if you're on mechanical hard drives. So in my opinion, even worst case, it's not that bad. And I am doing it in the unoptimal way with VMs running on the system, which generally is fine, but not recommended. And all you should need after this is a reboot and it's back online. And that reboot shouldn't take any extra time. It'll just load the new kernel when it completes its reboot. One other cool feature I'd love to see Proxmox add is the ability to upgrade the kernel without a reboot, like some distros have added, just to reduce the amount of reboots I have to do when doing it there. And if everything goes to plan, I should reboot the system and be running Proxmox 9 and check that I'm running the new kernel using uname-a on this system. Now that I've gone over the in-place upgrade and done a fresh install in one of my boxes, let's take a look at some new features they may have added. So this is a test system I set up a little bit ago. And one thing I am curious about first is they mentioned those are new features when it comes to snapshots and how that works. So I'm going to go into storage, and it should apply for directory storage as well as SMB and NFS storage. So I got a USB SSD attached to the system, so I'm going to give that a try and just see how it works and how it's laid out under the hood when I create a little Debian VM on that store. So I've started doing some snapshot tests on this little Debian VM I've created. And what it does now is when I make a snapshot and run ls, I could see that those the original disk images, and now all the snapshots, it says snap-test1, are a separate qcow2 file. And when I run ls-l to see those size, it looks like they're all the full disk size. So what I believe with this is you can just copy one of these and make an image from it, and deleting it is a lot easier. My quick gut is it's doing something fancy with the file system or something else under the hood to not just use all the space that it would otherwise do, because even though I haven't used all the space on the VM, it's only using very minimal space when I take a snapshot. So if I make a third snapshot, for example, I went from about 5.2 gigabytes of disk space used before that snapshot was made, and I'd expect about 7.2 because I have 2 gigs of RAM and it's making a full image of the RAM every time. So yeah, 7 gigs about. So it's working very well at using only the minimum amount of disk space, but only doing that. The one other thing that I have seen and been annoyed with before is you can't remove anything other in ZFS, at least, than the oldest snapshot. So you have to only delete the snapshots in order or keep them all. And this lets me arbitrarily delete snapshots, which is a cool feature. And if I take a look at this system, I get all that disk space back. So at first glance, this seems like a better way to do snapshots if you're on disk storage. That promises better performance and better cleanup, which I know Qcow 2 isn't quite as good at raw at doing so. So seems like a nice upgrade, especially if you're using NFS, Samba, or just directory storage in Proxmox. The one other new thing that's talked about in the release notes that I'm the most excited about is that PVE network interface pinning. So when I have headless systems, I don't have to mess with network adapters and bring out a monitor. So it doesn't look like there's a full man page here, and I just want to quickly try out this 2FN generate and see what it does. So it looks like it says name for link will be Nick0 for my Wi-Fi on this little mini PC, Nick1 for these systems, created link files, and there it goes. And then it says reboot your system to apply those changes. Here, it looks like it's edited my bridge to use the new Nick0 name. And then what it's done is it's added Nick0 as my interface. Now, I need to look deeper into what exactly Proxmox is doing under the hood. But if I take a look at the ETC network interfaces files, it's just replaced that ENP3S0 I think I was using with Nick0, and it seems to be working fine. I might make a future video about this because this is a common problem I've seen on systems, and see, does adding more SSDs or other PCIe devices still cause problems? But if this fixes it, I'm really happy. These are some of the bigger, more exciting features for me to take a quick look at this intro video on PVE Beta 9. Let me know if there's anything exciting that you're excited to see in this PVE Beta 9 release, and let me know in the comments below. I'm looking forward to seeing what your thoughts are, if I should do more tests on anything else like this in Proxmox Beta, and just what your overall thoughts on this new release are. I hope you enjoyed this little video, and there's definitely going to be more Proxmox content on this channel to come in the future. Thanks for watching.